Restoration Life family, we're so happy you joined us today. Our prayer is that this message speaks directly to your life and has restoration power. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to stay up to date on our upcoming messages. Now, let's take a listen.
Everybody ready? Everyone excited? Praise God. Put that seatbelt on. You're going to need it. Hey, we want to take a quick minute and also welcome those who are tuning in by way of live stream. Can we give them a big God bless you today? Wherever you're tuning in from, we pray that you're just as impacted by the Word of God as we are here today in person. We pray that God's going to move and meet you right where you're at. How many would agree with that this morning? Amen. My name is Nick, and I have the privilege of bringing the Word today. Our pastor, Pastor Eddie, was preaching at a conference in New Jersey at Church Alive, and he's ministering this morning there, and I was able to see how God was moving today through the ministry of really Restoration Life and us releasing him to be there. But he sends his love all the way from New Jersey. He will be back in the house with us for Father's Day. Any fathers in the house? Hey, fathers, listen, get here next Sunday. It's going to be a powerful time. Turn to your neighbor and say, bring someone. Bring your uncle. Bring your Nino, your godfather, your grandpa, your stepdad, your neighbor's dad. Bring a dad. We want to celebrate all the dads in the house next Sunday. Is that all right, church? It's going to be a powerful time. And today we're going to continue in our series of talks entitled Embers. How many of you were here last week as Pastor Eddie kicked off Embers? Powerful time, and we're going to pick up where we left off in the book of 2 Timothy. It's our theme scripture, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6 through 8. If you have your Bible, open it up. We're going to go ahead and read that, and we're going to have it up on the screen right now in just a moment. When you're there, say amen. All right, here we go. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has given us a spirit not of what? But of power and love and self-control. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner. Don't forget the prisoner. But share in the suffering for the gospel by the power of God. Today, I just want to brush up on what an ember is for those of you who were not here. Embers are the glowing remnants of a fire, often seen as small smoldering pieces of wood or coal that continue. I love this. You can't count it out there, even though it's small and smoldering. They continue to radiate heat and light after the initial flames have died down. See, embers retain heat for a long time and can reignite a fire if fanned or given more fuel. They provide a steady, consistent glow rather than the bright flickering light of a flame. See, embers have the potential to reignite into a full flame when the right conditions are met. And just like embers, our faith can remain strong, steady, even during the times when you don't feel excited or passionate, even though you've been through things. Let me tell you something. Though you may feel like you're about to ash out, God could fan you right back into a full flame. Come on, a full flame. God wants to do something in us today. Amen. See, our spiritual life may feel like it's dwindling, like it's ashing out, but with the right encouragement, the right prayer, the right community, the right discipleship, the right environment, the right posture of surrenderance, God could fan you right back into flame. I believe that this word is for someone today who you've been dwindling. You feel like, man, this has been tough. There's no signs of flame in my life anymore. Matter of fact, I identify more with the ashes of my past. I don't know that I could continue to find fuel for tomorrow. I'm about to ash out. Can anyone relate this morning? See, it's my understanding that a lot of times we look for an escape. We look for a way out, but God wants to offer you an encounter today. And it's my understanding that it just takes one touch from God, one breath of life breathed into us, and we could be fanned right back into flame. I believe that God's going to use this word today to encourage someone, to give someone a revelation, an understanding that you can't count out an ember. Your ember season, it's an enduring season. It's not an ending season. God wants to fan someone right back into flame this morning as we bow our head and close our eyes. Father, I thank you. I thank you for already moving. Thank you for your spirit dwelling in this house. Thank you for the powerful time of worship. And Father, we just come before you right now and we just ask for you to have your way this morning. God, do what only you could do. Father, we pray for an increase this morning. Lord, you moved in first service. You moved powerfully in second service. And we believe that you're going to do it again right now, right here today. Lord, I pray for those who are struggling this morning, those who need a touch from heaven. God, I pray that they would encounter you right where they're at. Father, remind us today, you're not done with this. In Jesus' name. And the church said, amen, amen. If you believe that, give the Lord a big hand clap. Today, when we talk about an ember, a fire pit, what I began to think about and ponder on is the importance of guarding that flame. In other words, you know, spiritually speaking, guarding our heart. Because it's my understanding that in order to produce a strong flame and keep it lit, you have to tend to it. The conditions have to be right for the flame to burn bright and strong and consistent. Amen. Anyone ever been camping before? You understand that it's not just set it and forget it when it comes to lighting a fire. You gotta fan that flame. When the wood begins to burn out, when the season of that log comes to an end, it's time to add another log, amen. See, and for you and I, what we have to understand is just like tending to the fire in the physical, in the spiritual, it's the same. You have to guard your heart. You wouldn't just add anything to a fire. Because how many of you guys know nails in a fire are no good? They begin to pop and fly outside and hit people. You wouldn't put metal into a fire. You wouldn't put rubber into a fire because it'll just smell. But wood is meant to be put in the fire to continue the consistent burn. Amen. And today what I want to talk about is comparison. See, comparison and even compromise. We're going to touch on some compromise today. And how a lot of us, we let our guard down and we let any voice from comparison and compromise to dwindle and fan out our flame in a negative way. See, not every fan's a good fan for your flame. How many of you guys know that what it is to compare and to compromise, it's like putting a water hose right in a fire. All you'll begin to see is smoke. And there's too many smoky individuals walking around looking ashy today. Some of y'all looking real ashy. Don't turn to your neighbor and tell them they look ashy. Not gonna do that. Not today. But be reminded that God is calling you out of your ashes. Today, the title of the sermon is Out of the Ashes. Because God's calling you out of the dead things. God's calling you out of your past. God's calling you out of your hurt. And God's calling you to burn bright in his future for your life. Amen. Today, my hope is that you leave with this understanding that we can't be influenced by everything. Someone say influence. Influence. We all want to be influenced by someone or something. See, Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20 through 27. This is where our key text is going to be found today. We're going to read over this. It says this, "My son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ear to my words. Do not let them out of your sight, but keep them within your heart. For they are life to those who find them and health to one's whole body. Above all else, guard your what? Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Keep your mouth free from perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. In other words, keep that gossip out your mouth. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Give careful thought to the paths for your feet. And be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or to the left. Keep your foot from evil. Verse 23 tells us, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. And this is a reminder of the importance of protecting our heart from even the influences of not only the world, but those we seek to be influenced by. It's not just the world and culture influencing us. It's the family member that we looked up to growing up. It's the friend from elementary school who was always popular. We wanted to be just like them and have what they had. And we wanted the attention that they were getting, so we would seek the attention and trying to mimic who they are. See, and if you're not careful, when you find so much identity in someone else, if you're not careful, you'll become the counterfeit version of them instead of the authentic version of you. See, you're one of one this morning. You're not called to look like your neighbor on the left or to the right. You're called to live in the identity that Christ has given you, set out before you. You were fearfully and wonderfully made in the perfect image of God. Come on, you're not meant to look like the social media influencer. And I'm not knocking all of them because they're not all bad. The problem is we find so much identity in who they are that we lose sight and devalue who God's called you to be. Let's keep it real. I seek influence too. I love being influenced. I love being mentored. I believe that there's good influences in our life, but I have to understand that I'm not meant to mimic them. I'm meant to be discipled, raised up, to become a man of God who I've been called to be in my identity. I'm not supposed to look like the person preaching down the street. I'm not supposed to preach like Pastor Eddie. That would be hard to do. Thank God. I don't have the hair for it either. But let me tell you something. I know who I am. I know who I am. We also have to understand where our help comes from, because if we walk in this arrogance that we're self-made, man, it's the self-made ones who end up falling flat on their face because their strength is only found in them. I want you to remember something today. In order to burn bright for the things of God, you got to do it according to his word and according to his ways. Who would agree with that? Amen. Amen. See, if we're not careful, like I said, we'll become these counterfeit versions of these people that we seek influence by. But 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33, it says it like this. Do not be misled. Someone say bad company. Those bad influences, those bad relationships, those ungodly conversations. Come on, somebody. That tia that's trying to speak into your marriage that's been divorced 4 times. Your broke uncle who's trying to give you financial advice. Hey, mijo, are you sure you're able to start that business? I don't know. And it's like, bro, when's the last time you had a job? Why are you speaking into what I'm trying to do right now? But let's keep it real. We love on people so much that rather than looking at their fruit, we just hear them out. And sometimes we let those words fall on good soil in our lives, and the weeds overturn the garden. Come on, am I talking to anyone today? Anyone ever just take bad advice because it was from someone that you looked up to? I'ma just trust them. And that's our problem. We trust influence more than truth sometimes. Some of you are putting water on your fire because it's coming from someone you look up to. And when you do this, all you see is no longer evidence of fire, but you see evidence of smoke. And smoke gets stinky. It gets nasty. It burns your eyes. It burns your throat. When you're around smoke, you begin to smell like it. It's not fun to be around. Anyone ever been around a smoky fire? It's not fun to be around it. There's no evidence of life. There's no evidence of flame, but what it's evidence of is something dead, something that's no longer burning. But see, this is what the world says about you sometimes. Because how many of you guys know we get into ashy situations and smoky environments sometimes? But it's my understanding that sometimes when a flame has fully diminished and dissolved, the remnant that's left is the embers. And though the flame is no longer lit and burning bright, the embers are still steady and consistent. And out of the ashes, listen to me, out of the ashes, if the right environment, if the right community, if the right discipleship, if the right fuel for the flame to come back into fruition is met, there's still potential for you to burn. You're not hearing me today. Today, you're in the room and you've been compromising. You've been comparing yourself to others. You've been diminishing your own value. You've been listening to the wrong words. You've been listening to the wrong people speaking into your life rather than speaking life into your situation. Let me tell you something. You better thank God today that you're still here, because since you're here, there's still evidence of a flame. There's still evidence that God could fan you right back into it. Though you may not be a flame in the moment, there's still a fire that wants to burn within you. But we gotta stop allowing nonsense to speak into our life. We gotta stop being moved by comparison and compromises. I think it's crazy that we'll compromise so much to find an escape when God wants to meet us in an encounter. We'll compromise so much and give up everything that God has for us for a quick way out. All because we don't value where we're currently at. We don't value what God's trying to do in this lesson. We don't value who God says you are. You don't value what his plans are for your life. Forgive me for being a little passionate today, but I'm sick and tired of watching brothers and sisters sit in their ashes, playing with ashes, when God's called you to be the light unto the world. Come on. Some of you guys have been playing with your ash for far too long. You've been sitting in ashes, A-S-H. Just to be clear, I'm not cussing up here. But let's be honest, it gets tempting to find the easy way out. It's easy to allow a little bit of sin in. The sin that maybe no one's gonna ever find out about. But here's what happens. When you allow that mindset to take even a little bit of root in your life, let me tell you again, it just takes one weed to overturn a whole garden of roses. What have you allowed to speak into your life this morning? Who are you trying to measure your life to? What do you think success is? Are you trying to find fulfillment in the world's standard of success? Are you trying to find fulfillment in what the world says success looks like, what the world says love looks like, what the world says happiness looks like? Are you trying to identify love, success, and enjoyment with the standards of the world? Because if you are, let me tell you something, you're in for a world of hurt, a world of pain. Because compromise never has led to breakthrough. It's the very reason why some of us are still here today, bound by the same addiction we've been bound to for the last 20 years, hiding in sin. I preached this sermon. This is not in my notes, so I hope I don't get too derailed. But talking about hiding in sin, I had the privilege of taking our young adults up to a camp last summer. And I preached a sermon entitled Hide and Seek. Because it's my understanding that a lot of us are hiding in the wrong places, seeking the wrong things. We're hiding in sin when in reality we could hide in his presence. He's given us an opportunity to come to the throne room of grace, to find him in his presence, not just for a quick out, but actually to go through a season of restoration. Healing, restoration, breakthrough. See, compromise does not lead to breakthrough. It leads to breakdowns. Some of you wonder this morning why I can't get out of these ashes I've been in. Why can't I get over this thing that I'm bound to? Why have I not found restoration? Friend, what are you pouring in your fire? Is this okay this morning? I hope so, because I'm tired of watching people with so much potential burn out their own flame by allowing the wrong voices to speak into you. By finding value in what culture says about you, what people you grew up with think about you. This is real. Let's not act like it's not. A lot of us are so moved by what others think. Imagine if I came in here to speak a word only to find comfort in knowing that someone said, hey, you did a good job today. God forbid that day ever came, because I would just be telling you what you want to hear and not what you need to hear. I'd be preaching to you a prosperity gospel that's actually imaginary, that if you just give $10, God will provide 10 miracles for you right now. Come on, go ahead, put the QR code up. Let's go. Anybody got $10 right now to give for 10 miracles? No. But God's plan is for you to prosper, but you have to do it according to his will and his way for your life. So maybe you've been stuck, maybe you've been bound, maybe you've been defeated, maybe you're ashing out right now. Let me tell you something. You're not ashed out yet, because there's still an ember burning. There's still potential. But you can't compromise. You can't compare, because you're one of one. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're one of one. Turn to your second choice and say, you are one of one. See, when we talk about guarding our heart, have you heard the saying, show me who your friends are and you'll show me who you are? Or I'll tell you who you are? It's real. That's for real, for real. Who are you surrounding yourself with? Would you try to light a fire in a bucket of water? Would you try to light a fire in the beach water, in the ocean? No. You'll never see the fire be lit. You'll find yourself sitting there trying to light something in the wrong environment. So how are you going to thrive according to the way God desires you to thrive if you find yourself around the wrong people, receiving the wrong words, the wrong encouragement? Whose voice are you listening to today? Here's what scripture talks about in Proverbs chapter 4, 19. It talks about the heart, that it should be kept for wisdom, guarding it against the ways of the wicked. The Bible also talks about, it warns us to avoid a double heart in Psalms chapter 12. It talks about in Proverbs 28, 14, a hard heart. In Proverbs 21:4, it talks about a proud heart. It talks about in Hebrews chapter 3, verse 12, an unbelieving heart. A cold heart, it talks about in Matthew 24:12. And in Psalms 51:10, it warns us about an unclean heart. What does your heart look like this morning? See, there will be many opportunities to give your heart to a person or a path that wisdom would preach against. Yeah, that relationship that you're pursuing that isn't healthy for you. That sexual relationship that is totally contradicting what God says in Scripture. That same-sex attraction you're trying to validate because love is love. This is real. This is real. And when we allow compromise in, listen, you allow in deceit. You partner with the lies of the enemy at its finest in those moments. But let me tell you something, those lies don't lead to anything other than deeper wounds, stronger hurts, and greater pains. Greater pains. I don't know about you, I'm not in this to find great pain. But I want to see great progress in my life. I want to see great breakthrough in my life. I want to be able to tell the story how I once was jacked up, but thank God he found me. He picked me up, dusted me off, brought me up out of my ashes, out of my past, out of my hurt, out of the embarrassing things I've done, and fanned me right back into a full flame. Someone say a full flame. Come on, he wants to do it for you today. If you believe that, would you just say amen to that? That God wants to do it in you. God wants to do it in you. See, comparison shifts our focus from God's plan for our lives to what others are achieving in theirs. And it's easy for us to compare our life or status to the success of others when we're so moved by what others think. A lot of times we do this because we see something someone else has, and we can't help but to want that for our lives. But the way we go about trying to achieve that is doing it out of pocket. When you're so fixated on what God's doing in someone else, hear me again, you will lose the value. You will lose sight. You will lose the way and how to do it because you don't want to copy and paste someone else's life. But the problem with that is this. God's called you to something special. He's called you to something special. He's called you to something special. You to something special. You tuning in online, he's called you to something special. And we're called to be different in ways we've been given gifts. It's time to fan the flame, fan those gifts. Start to hone in on that word. Develop those giftings. Put them into practice. It's time to be active about the things of God in our life. But you got to stop comparing yourself to others. And most importantly, stop comparing your future and your today to the dead things that are in the ashes. The last time I checked, you can't find directions from dead things. Last time I checked, I can't find hope in something that's dead. I have a hope in Jesus because he's resurrected. He's not on the cross dead anymore. I find hope in something that's living. So why do we run back to what's dead? Why do we find so much value in what's lost? And in what wasn't meant for this next chapter? Because some of those things that were distractions were easy to do. Breakthrough is hard sometimes. Being vulnerable is tough. This conversation isn't easy. Thank God for strength, because some of you are looking at me like, bro, don't talk to me like that. Don't call me out. You don't know what I've been through. I don't, but I know that God wants to break through today. God wants to pull you out of the mess you've been in. God wants to remind you today that where man sees ashes, he sees embers. He sees potential. Where man would see something dead, God's fanning something new into flame. God's fanning something new, amen. Comparison leads to these three things, and I only got 11 minutes, so I got to move quickly.
Turn to your neighbor and say, we got to keep up. See, when we compare ourselves to others, we miss out on the journey that God has specifically for us. Comparison leads to these three things. The first is discontentment. When we compare our current situation to someone else's or to our own past, we can quickly become discontent. Discontentment blinds us to the blessings and opportunities that God has placed before us. Not only will discontentment dampen our enthusiasm, but it will make you lose sight of God's purpose for your life. Discontentment will put your flame out. You'll lose direction in how to fan anything back into flame. The second thing it breeds is envy. See, the truth is there's some of you in here today that find more value in what's happening in the person next to you or in the person that you look up to, so much more that you lose sight on what God wants to do in you right now. You missed that one. You're in a situation right now for a reason. Nothing is for loss. Listen, every bad situation you've ever encountered, God will turn that around and use it for his glory. Because, listen, this is the beauty of it. God is not going to leave you where you're at. His desire is to pick you up, build you up, and release you into purpose. Purpose isn't found in sitting in your ashes, though. James 3:16 says it like this: "For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice." Comparison breeds this envy, which consumes our thoughts and will take up all your energy. And you'll find yourself literally, pun intended here, burnt out. Anyone ever feel burnt out? It's an indication that your focus is not on your flame. Can I say that again? When you feel like you're burning out, it's an indication that you haven't spent time in the throne room. It's an indication that you've been so moved by the books you're reading. And hear me again, I read books too, come on. Let's be smart. But let's do a little math right now. We're not called to mimic the author. We're not called to copy and paste, glean, edify. But what I'm saying is, so many times we want to be just like someone else, that you literally, by doing that, when you partner with that idea that I want to mimic someone, you tell God that you didn't give me a good enough identity in who you called me to be. That one might sting a little bit. You might get that one on the way home as you're driving. But it's reality, friend. God wants to do something special in you today. You've been holding on to your hurt. You've been holding on to those relationships. Like, God, I wish it would have just worked out, but God's trying to get you to understand that I got something better for you. I got something greater for you. I have something in my will for you. Sometimes the things of your will have to die for you to receive what's in my will for you. Does this make sense? Is the mathing right now? The third thing that comparison breeds is insecurity. Insecurity can be such a heavy burden to carry. Insecurity keeps us hiding. Insecurity silences our voice. Insecurity, not only does it affect your heart, it affects your mind. God called you to be bold, courageous. Your strength is found in Him. Your encouragement is found in Him, not in what the words that others say about you. Remember this: hurt people hurt people. Hurt people will call you out for trying to be better. God wants you to be healed and restored, and the hurt people will say, look at you being all different. Look at you, you think you're better than us. Oh, so-and-so doesn't hang out with us anymore because they're different. You're darn right I'm different, because I'm tired of sitting in my ashes. You're darn right I'm changing, because God's doing something in me. You better believe that I'm not going to hang around the same toxic environments, the gossip talks. You could leave me out of that gossip group chat. I don't want that. I want something that's edifying, uplifting, something that will build me up, equip me, something that will call me out of the mess I was once in and encourage me to step out in faith, not by what's seen, but by what's known, that if the Lord called me to it, He will pull me through it. Amen. God's called you to burn bright for Him, but I wonder if you'll stop listening to the lies of insecurity. I wonder if you'll stop being envious of the fire that another brother or sister has and start fanning your flame to burn bright like God's called you to burn bright. I wonder if you can see past your hurt this morning and understand that your life still holds value. Maybe you're here today and you've been wrestling with just feeling good enough to get up and get out of the house. Man, God, is there anything you could still do with this? I'm reminded of the last sermon I preached. Why would God want to use someone like me? There's so many of us that feel this way often. We get the pace going. We begin to feel just good enough spiritually, and then we don't focus on the flame anymore. We're good enough. God doesn't want you to be where you're at right now. He wants to bring you out and make you better. God wants to use your life today. God wants you to burn bright for him. God wants you to tell the story how you were once at the end of it all. You were once suicidal. Come on, I'm talking to the hurt person right now, that you were church hurt. Man, I would never serve in ministry again because of what I've been through. You know, I had someone who I looked up to my whole life tell me that God would never use me in my full potential. 18 years old, young man, pursuing my wife at the time, telling me that there's plenty of other fish in the sea, that she's not the one for me. Just really trying to destruct what God was trying to do. Thank God that I understood that hurt people hurt people. And even though this person was of influence to my life, I could understand that he was dealing with something. And you have a choice this morning. In every opportunity to make a good choice, you have an opportunity to listen to the lies of the enemy. God has not left you. He has not forsaken you. You're sitting here today. You're about to ash out. God wants to fan the flame above the ashes, friend. God wants to do something in your life. And I wonder if there's anyone that understood the value that God could still use you. Though you may be broken right now, God wants you to know that you're a work in progress. You may not be perfect, but he's perfecting you. This is a journey. Put another log of hope in the fire. Let the fire burn. Someone say, let the fire burn. Let's stand to our feet this morning. The ashes of our past. I want to remind you what Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah 61, verse 2 and 3. It says this: to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. I wonder if you understood this today. Friend, you're carrying heaviness today. You're carrying heartbreak, the wounds that man caused, the wounds that your parents caused, the hurt of your childhood. It's affecting why you're not stepping into the full flame today, why you're not experiencing a move of God, because you're still bound to the hurt of your past. God wants you to surrender that mess to him. He wants those ashes. He wants to give you beauty. He wants to give you joy. He wants to give you peace. He wants to restore what was once broken so he can use it for his glory. God wants to do something in your life today. But you got to position yourself in the throne room. Position yourself in the presence of God. You have to be willing to say, God, here I am. Don't just have my future, but I got to give you my past in order to step into my future. And as hard as that may be, God wants to meet you right where you're at today. Wounded and hurting, God wants to love on you this morning. And maybe this is just for a couple people today. You are worth it. God put this in my heart today for the person who needed to hear it. But it's a reminder for the rest of us that we are to guard what God is doing in us. Guard your heart. Don't listen to the lies of the enemy. Don't be influenced by the world, but be an influence to the world. We're called to be a change, to burn bright. This morning, if that's you, you're struggling right there where you're at, as we bow our head and close our eyes, I believe the Lord's already touching you. The Lord's revealing things that you need to surrender, the hurt, the lies, the hurtful things that people said about you, that you would never be anything. God can't use you. Are you kidding me? With your story of what you've been through? You've been divorced twice. You have two baby dads. You individual who don't know how to father your kids. You individual, you'll never be a good dad because of your anger. You'll never be a good dad because of your past mistakes. Or how about you, the one that was told by the teacher that you would never amount to anything? We face tough situations in this life. But I want to remind you today the importance of guarding the words that you allow into the gate of your heart. Guard your heart, young person. Guard your heart, old person. God's desire isn't for you to run back to your ashes. His desire for us is to rise above them. We all have these moments in our life that we identify as ashes. Things that have come to an end that no longer serve a purpose. Why do we sit in our ashes? Why do we mourn? Why do we indulge in the spirit of heaviness when Jesus gave us something so much better? God's desire this morning is to give you beauty instead of those ashes. But in reality, we have to understand it's time to pull out the investment on what's dead in our life. You're so invested to dead relationships, so invested to identifying to those circles where you found influence. God's saying, pull out that investment. God's saying, find a future in me. Find hope in me. Find healing in me. This is resonating with you. I see you this morning. God's speaking to you. There's people that you've been hanging around with that are no good for you. They'll never help you get to where God's calling you to be. Stop with this mindset of a little bit of compromise won't hurt. A little bit of this won't hurt. It just takes a weed to overturn a garden. God's promise this morning is to replace our ashes with His beauty. Stop diminishing your value. Stop diminishing your value. Stop belittling yourself because of what you look like in the moment. I don't know about you, but I refuse to diminish the call of God on my life. I refuse to count God out. Because the last time I checked, as long as there's still an ember, there's still potential. As we bow our head and close our eyes this morning, this message spoke to you. You've been counting yourself out. You're saying, God, I just don't feel it anymore. I'm not excited about church. I'm not excited about the call. I'm not excited about serving your house. I'm not excited about even living for you. I can't find joy. All I feel is hurt. All I hear is torment from my past. God wants you to surrender your ashes in exchange for beauty, in exchange for renewal, in exchange for hope, in exchange for your future. If that's you this morning, not looking to the left or to the right, get out of your seat. Get out of your seat. God wants to encounter you this morning. God wants to do something new in you. Come on, don't wait for the next person to step out. God wants to do something in your life this morning. God wants to do something in you this morning. You're here today and you've been so bound to anxiety and depression. You've been so bound to insecurity. You found so much value in who others say you are that you've lost sight in who you really are. God wants to work on you this morning. Get out of your seat. Get out of your seat. Make a decision that, God, I'll live for you. I don't care what the world says about me. I don't care what my family says about me. I choose you today. If that's you, get out of your seat. God wants to do something in you. And maybe you're here today and you simply don't know Jesus. but you heard that there's potential for you. Maybe you're the individual here that all you've grown up in is hurt. All you've grown up in is disappointment. All you've ever experienced in your life is letdown. I want you to know that you're in the right place today, because God wants to meet you where you've been let down. And God wants to show you the goodness of Him. God wants to show you grace where others haven't. God wants to show you love where others didn't show you. God wants to heal your wounds. God wants to restore you back into a full, vibrant flame. And if you want to know Jesus today, right where you're at, just lift your hands. Hands going up. Hands going up in the back. If you want to give your life to Jesus, together as a family, we're going to say this together. Say, Jesus, I give you my life. I surrender all to you. I repent of my past. I surrender my ashes. Lord, I receive your beauty. I receive the gift of salvation. Thank you for paying what I could not pay. Today I confess that I'm a sinner. But Lord, I want to receive grace. I want to be renewed. So I accept you as not just my Lord, but I declare today you're my Savior. And Lord, I thank you because today's the day that I choose purpose. Today's the day where I allow you to use my life to tell the story how I once was lost. But Lord, you found me, and I'll never be the same. In Jesus' name. Come on, if you believe that and if you said that prayer, would you just give the Lord a big shout of praise? Come on, He's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be praised. Let's sing this song. Let's worship Him.
Pour your spirit out. Pour your spirit out.
we thank you. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy. In Jesus' name. Let's declare this together. Say, Jesus, today's the day where we fan the flame. We come out of our ashes and we embrace the future. We will guard our hearts, live in accordance to your word. And Father, we choose you in your path for our lives. That we would be world shakers and environment changers in Jesus' name. And if you believe that about yourself, that you're gonna be different, would you just give the Lord a shout of praise? Come on, that you're gonna light the flame, you're gonna live in full potential, not watering down the gospel for anybody. Come on, we can't afford to compromise anymore. Would you agree? Listen. I believe that every single person in here today needs to just be reminded. It's not about where you're at. It's about where you're going. It's not about where you're currently at. This ain't the period of what God's doing in your life. It's not the ending. But God's putting a new log to the fire. Come on. Someone say, add a new log. It's time to add a new log. I love you. God bless you. And we're going to turn it over to Jesse today.
That was a word for someone here today. Who here is ready to fan into flame their ember with the Holy Spirit so that we can be a forest fire of revival for the South Bay? Just a few quick announcements. I know you want to get out of here like, what, more? But if you were baptized at Baptized California, you have a shirt and a certificate in the office. And please, next Sunday, do not forget, it is Father's Day. And there are only two services, an 8:30 and a 10:30. So if you come at 12:30, you'll miss out. And like always, if you've accepted Christ, if you want to get plugged into a life group, if you want to call Restoration Life your home, please scan this QR code. If you want prayer, please scan this QR code. But if you want it right now and you want to speak to someone and you want to pray right now, don't miss out, because on the way out, you'll see the prayer booth and the VIP booth where people want to pray with you and talk with you. God bless and go in peace.
Put me back together.